Why don't I do a couple of announcements, Steve, because there may still be a couple more people who will Zoom in and give them some Zoom details. That sound good? We are going to, it is a joy to see you guys. We're going to Zoom these services through the rest of February. And then even if we're able to start in-person services, we may continue Zooming so that we have, like we got Sylvia and Caroline and Bill, we got people who can't physically be here and other folks too. So let's keep that in mind. We are about 10 days away from Ash Wednesday when we turn the liturgical corner and we move into preparations for Lent. And I want to tell you, our altar guild is so on top of this. I think our virtual Ash Wednesday services are going to be really meaningful. We'll do one at noon. We will do one at 7 p.m. That's not this Wednesday, but a week from this Wednesday in about 10 days. We'll also print a bulletin, an Ash Wednesday service bulletin, and have hard copies of it for you if you want one. Of course, we'll always send you electronic copies. We are also, because of our tremendous altar guild, they are preparing cups of ashes. And you will notice when you see them, it doesn't take a lot of ashes for us to impose ashes on ourselves or each other. So in this hand, I've got ashes for a one or two person household like mine. Here's ashes for a three or more person household. So it will look like there's not enough, but there is plenty. We know it really doesn't take that much. And what we're inviting everyone to do this year is impose ashes in the virtual service as we move through it. I'm gonna impose ashes on myself at the noon service and at a 7 p.m. service. We'll record the services as well, I hope, so that you could watch the service at other times of the day. And you could impose ashes on yourself. Does that make sense? So that the Ash Wednesday service is something we'll all undertake, and we can impose ashes on each other in the service while we're doing it with each other, and yet we can impose ashes with our family members as well during the service, or whenever you want to play the service or just conduct the service with the leaflet. So here's what the Altar Guild is preparing these now, and they will have these containers ready for you to come pick up on the gazebo at the church starting this Wednesday and every day for the following week through next Ash Wednesday. And so you could come and pick up a container of ashes that you'll take home with you. They've already, actually I'm going to bless these when we come to the communion time, I'll bless these ashes. And they've come from Palm Sunday palms. So you could come pick up your ash container anytime between this Wednesday and Ash Wednesday. If you cannot get to the church, Sylvia, could put some in the mail if you and Bill want us to mail you some. So contact the office, okay, Sylvia, because I'll forget. Contact the office, and if you can't, you're in the area on the Outer Banks and you can't get over here, let us know and we'll get a container of ashes to you and a worship bulletin. Does that make sense? But if you can come by and pick them up sometime between this Wednesday and next Wednesday, we will have these containers on the gazebo waiting for you to come retrieve them. So did that make sense? Anybody have a question about that? Beth, if anybody have a question, go ahead and unmute yourself. You may be talking about something else. Okay. Well, I'm thinking this is going to be a wonderful way for us to be as fully participating in the Ash Wednesday service as any of us can. So, also, when we enter into Lent, the first Sunday of Lent will be a day when we also celebrate Episcopal Relief and Development. That's the national arm of the Episcopal Church that ministers in the name of the Episcopal Church worldwide. And we'll take meditations from them through the whole Lenten season, as well as some incredible Wednesday Lenten meditations Eve Turek will present to us in our parish emails, and we'll discuss at our Thursday evening Compline services in Lent. Let us worship the Lord in spirit and in truth. Son and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be God's kingdom, now and forever.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Set us free, O God, from the bondage of our sins, and give us the liberty of that abundant life which you have made known to us in your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. A reading from the book of Isaiah. Have you not known? Have you not heard? Has it not been told to you from the beginning? Have you not understood from the foundations of the earth? It is he who sits above the circle of the earth, and its inhabitants are like grasshoppers, who stretches out the heavens like a curtain and spreads them like a tent to live in, who brings princes to naught and makes the rulers of the earth as nothing. Scarcely are they planted, scarcely sown, scarcely has their stem taken root in the earth, when he blows upon them and they wither, and the tempest carries them off like stubble. To whom then will you compare me, or who is my equal, says the Holy One? Lift up your eyes on high and see who created these. He who brings out their host and numbers them, calling them all by name, because he is great in strength, mighty in power, not one is missing. Why do you say, O Jacob, and speak, O Israel, my way is hidden from the Lord, and my right is disregarded by my God? Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint and strengthens the powerless. Even youths will faint and be weary, and the young will fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm today is Psalm 147, and I'd like for us to read it together. Hallelujah! How good it is to sing praises to our God. How pleasant it is to honor him with praise. The Lord rebuilds Jerusalem. He gathers the exiles of Israel. He heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds. He counts the numbers of the stars and calls them all by their names. Great is our Lord and mighty in power. There is no limit to his wisdom. The Lord lifts up the lowly, but casts the wicked to the ground. Sing to the Lord with thanksgiving. Make music to our God upon the harp. He covers the heavens with clouds and prepares rain for the earth. He makes grass to grow upon the mountains and green plants to serve mankind. He provides food for flocks and herds and for the young ravens when they cry. He is not impressed by the might of a horse. He has no pleasure in the strength of a man, but the Lord has pleasure in those who fear him, in those who await his gracious favor. Hallelujah. The second reading is from Paul's first letter to the Corinthians. If I proclaim the gospel, this gives me no ground for boasting, for an obligation is laid on me, and woe to me if I do not proclaim the gospel. For if I do this of my own will, I will have a reward. But if not of my own will, I am entrusted with a commission. What then is my reward? Just this, that in my proclamation, I may make the gospel free of charge, so as not to make full use of my rights in the gospel. For though I am free with respect to all, I have made myself a slave to all, so that I might win more of them. To the Jews, I became a Jew in order to win Jews. To those under the law, I became as one under the law, though I myself am not under the law, so that I might win those under the law. To those outside the law, I became as one outside the law, though I am not free from God's law, but am under Christ's law, so that I might win those outside the law. To the weak, I became weak, so that I might win the weak. I have become all things to all people, that I might be, by all means, save some. I do it all for the sake of the gospel, so that I may share in its blessings. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus and his disciples left the synagogue at Capernaum and entered the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John. Now Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever, and they told him about her at once. He came and took her by the hand and lifted her up. Then the fever left her, and she began to serve them. That evening at sundown, they brought to him all who were sick or possessed with demons, and the whole city was gathered around the door. And he cured many who were sick with various diseases and cast out many demons. And he would not permit the demons to speak because they knew him. In the morning, while it was still very dark, he got up and went out to a deserted place, and there he prayed. And Simon and his companions hunted for him. When they found him, they said to him, "Everyone is searching for you." He answered, "Let us go on to the neighboring towns, so that I may proclaim the message there also, for that is what I came out to do." And he went throughout Galilee, proclaiming the message in their synagogues and casting out demons. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
I invite us into prayer, one written by Anne Osdiek. Lord, whole towns flocked to you with demons and sickness to be healed. In our day, we as well come to find you. Oh, Lord, heal us too. We are plagued with unrest and sickness. Our climate is in crisis, jobs are gone, and of course, the virus is upon the world. Take our hand, help us up. Let us take your good news to all of our sisters and brothers everywhere. Amen. I confess to you, my dear friends, that I have spent a good part of this past week in lament, punctuated by a brand new member of our country's House of Representatives who has, in her recent years, expressed extreme and violent points of view on several fronts. She is quoted as responding to a suggestion that a former U.S. president and secretary of state be hanged by saying, "The stage is set. Players are being put in place. We must be patient. This must be done perfectly, or such and such judges would let them off." That was quote, an unquote. She discounted well-documented school shootings in our history. One in Parkland, Florida, she called a false flag. The Sandy Hook Elementary shooting in Newtown, Connecticut, she asserted it was true that it had been staged. She had a host of other outrageous remarks, and with all of them that I was reading and watching her say, I could not fathom how other members of those in her same party declined in a vote to hold her accountable for her appalling words and positions. The next morning, I zoomed into a continuing education event, blanketed in profound sadness, that part of our nation's legislative body was supporting such an irresponsible lawmaker. Like, Lord, when is this going to end? Blessedly, the session I entered into was about the brain and how it prepares for healing in times of acute crisis. The presenter is a neuropsychologist, Dr. Angelo Balea. He works with people across the whole spectrum of brain function, high-functioning folks to those who have experienced severe brain trauma. And he began his time with us with an overview of our brain and by stating, the brain is designed for healing. And then he spoke of it in a way that as he's described them, he describes the brain and its parts. And I literally started thinking about Congress and thinking about rays of light that he was shining in both what's happening in our heads and what I saw in this political body. And then he continued to show us how this is a description of the richness and an affirmation of the diversity of who we are as people. So I'll tell you a bit about what he said. He began with our brain has three units, which together function as one. But he says the three-dimensional structure is just incredible. Because by this three-dimensional way of functioning, it enriches our lives. It provides potential for rich variety. It's more flexible and pliable. It gives us more tools and opportunities for healing. It's more resourceful because it's got three different components that function differently. And its composition is wise. The more he talked about this, the beauty of this elegant part of our, what's inside here, the more I turned from lament over our legislative branch and its total catastrophe to gratitude that we have two political parties and we got libertarians, independents, and more. We have three branches of federal government. We have a country of all kinds of people, a country of lands and seas and mountains and forests, of all kinds of houses of worship and people's ways of worshiping. And after this amazing journey through our brains, powers of healing, I'd love to do a whole session on that one day. I also discovered as I left the session that the fuller House of Representatives, with the combination of the two parties, indeed removed that irresponsible legislator from all committees. A fuller diversity of perspectives brought, in my opinion, greater wisdom to light. And I said, thank God. These are the kinds of challenges that you and I are experiencing day in and day out. And along with that, we meet this day our Lord as he's continuing his early days of ministry. We are still just in Mark's first chapter of the gospel. Jesus continuing to heal and preach in ways that are so far beyond what anyone had ever experienced or heard before. They flock to him literally for help. Jesus and his disciples have left the synagogue in Capernaum, that public place that's mostly for men. There's a women's court, but of course that's outdoors. The real happening is inside just for the men. And we go from this men's public place to the life center for women in those days. We go into the home of Simon and Andrew, and of course along go James and John as well. Ironically and wonderfully, this foursome of fishermen who 2 weeks ago left everything to follow him, we realize they've been able to, for this period of Jesus' ministry, they've been able to stay in their hometown. They've been able to stay some with their families, which is such a cool thing. When they tell him that Simon's mother-in-law was sick with fever, which is a very frightening occurrence in that day with no antibiotics, Jesus immediately goes to her, takes her by the hand and raised her. That's the actual Greek verb, lifted her up. This verb raising appears 18 times in Mark. Jesus does for her and for us what we cannot do on our own. He raises us to newness and greater strength of all kinds, even when we think, oh gosh, I'm so sick, I can't take another step. On the path of liberating us and signifying that Jesus is on the move to liberate us from whatever holds us back, from community, from purpose and a sense of calling, from singing our songs of love and good for all. Cynthia Kittredge announces that the healing of Peter's mother-in-law is the first resurrection story in the gospel because it is the same verb used when Jesus rises. The verb describing her rise to serve those around her is the same verb, diakonon, describing Jesus serving. It's also descriptive of the angels in the wilderness who come to serve him. Sarah Heinrich adds, this raised woman is the first character in Mark's gospel who exemplifies true discipleship. And she adds, Jesus shows over and over again that God's power serves the people. God comes to restore and save, and God's power is clearly sufficient to do it. So much so, in fact, that by sundown, the whole town has come to Simon and Andrew's house with all kinds of people who are sick and demon-possessed. And Jesus cures many and casts out many. And yet there's such a flood of humanity that have come out to him that early the next morning, he goes in the dark to withdraw to pray. Many went looking for him. And I wonder if he went to pray because he realized that the challenges of that place were so real. There was so much more there he could do, but also thinking of the people he had yet to meet, in places he had yet to visit, and ponder perhaps what his next steps would be. And when Simon and his friends come upon him, they say, everyone is searching for you. And he replies, let us proceed to neighboring towns so that I may proclaim the message there also, a message we know clearly of word and deed, for that is what I came out to do. The only time I see Jesus in the Gospels stop healing, if people have come to him for healing, is if he senses it's time to move on to the next town. Otherwise, there's no incident where he turns anybody away. So he went throughout Galilee, teaching, healing, and casting out demons. James Boyce, I love his phrase. He says, his story breathes of the power of forgiveness and healing that God has in store for the whole world, including us. You and I inhabit a world that can overwhelm us with its needs, with its suffering, into places where love and truth and honor are in short supply, or they look like they've just been lost utterly and completely. And yet we follow and are loved so deeply by this Lord who raises us up, breathes the power of forgiveness and healing into us, filling you and me with wellsprings of love and hope in our souls, and invites us to keep hanging in there in this adventure of liberation, even when we think everybody's in this, but I'm just being passed by. Maybe because I love history and I need a reminder that our country has faced even worse times before. I've been watching a docudrama of General and President Ulysses S. Grant. This was adapted from historian Ron Chernow's biography of him. And I'm telling you, I'm not through yet. I haven't gone all the way through it, but yet I have been so impressed with the transformations that man undergoes and then unfolds even in his early life chapters. It seems to me the spirit is at work in him. He was not a fan of organized religion, but I'm telling you, I sense the spirit and he have something going on. He was nicknamed, how would you like this as a nickname? Useless Grant was what he got nicknamed by the other kids in the town where he grew up. But listen, I'm quoting historians here. He comes from nothing and rises to the highest ranks of the Union Army. He fights bloody battles with an indomitable will to save the Union, to heal his country, to lead the nation towards justice for everybody. He's the unheroic hero of our greatest national epic, the American Civil War. His own grandfather joined the American Revolution, signs up for the Continental Army, and was present at the Battle of Bunker Hill. Grant, when I say Grant, I'm speaking to you of Ulysses. He could not stand his own father's profession in the leather trade, although he loved horses. Maybe that's why he didn't like the leather trade. One historian noted as a kid, he didn't show promise for anything. But then on the other hand, he does show this incredible affinity for horses, and he can do anything. You see, he's a horseman before a lot of people would ever have gotten on one. His father definitely has a mind of his own for what he wants Ulysses to be about. So he secures for him an appointment at West Point without ever telling him he's even looking for it. So he just announces one day, you've got an appointment to West Point. That's where you're going. Ulysses has no desire to be a soldier. And he says, I don't want to go. And his dad said, well, you're going. So he goes. Ironically, almost all the generals of the Civil War on both sides were graduates of West Point. And the fact that he knew them and knew their personalities was quite a gift to him when he found them on opposite sides and he had to encounter them on the battlefield. He's in the middle of his class, confessed he read lots of novels. All right, what a good dude. And of course, he is the best equestrian of his graduating class, but there's no space for anyone in the cavalry. And so he ends up in the infantry. The blessing of that is he falls in love with a sister of a friend in the infantry. Her name was Julia Dent. The funky thing was, her dad was a slaveholder. His dad was a staunch abolitionist. So he's right in the middle of this going on, what's happening. He and Julia fall in love. They keep it, they get engaged, but they keep it secret because her dad wants nothing to do with this guy. And he gets called in the meantime to the Mexican-American War, where the expansion of territory is outgoing toward California. He wants to be in the battles. And he discovers one strength about himself that's rather incredible. He can stay calm in the middle of battle. He never loses his wits. He keeps thinking, he keeps processing. He also loses friends in battle from early on, so he knows the cost of war from the start. But Julia waits for him, and when he comes back from that war, her father relents, they get married, but no one from Grant's family will come to the wedding, not a single member. He gets posted in the Pacific Northwest. Julia's already pregnant, so she stays home. And he's apart from her for 2 years. It's a desolate, isolated place. There's almost nothing to do. And he gets into drinking. He ends up with a choice of resigning or being court-martialed. He goes home. He's been away for 2 years. He's got two sons, one he'd never met. He wants his own home for his own family, not living in his father-in-law's household. But he cannot find a good way to earn a living. He will do anything, though, to keep his family out of poverty, even selling firewood. He lives alongside the Dent slaves. He's not an abolitionist, although his father-in-law gives him a slave, William Jones. Grant states, "I don't know why a black skin may not cover a true heart as well as a white one." And in his own troubled morals and convictions, he goes to the Circuit Court of St. Louis in 1859, and he frees that enslaved man, William Jones. The court representative says to him, "I know somebody who'd give you $1,000 for that man. Are you sure you want to set him free when you could make some money?" And Grant frees him. He turns to the freed man and says, "God protect you, William." And William replies, "You also, sir." They rose that day as men, as equals, and they both knew they needed God to be with them. Ta-Nehisi Coates, I didn't say his name correctly. He's a very famous African-American writer, and he notes, he said, "Grant, freeing an enslaved human at that point when he is so poor is like walking away from your house." He says, "I know that sounds callous, but he's walking away from the greatest asset you could possibly have at the time when he is poor. It is a tremendous act of courage." Now, he's still looking for things to do. It's a year before the Civil War, and he goes back to his father and asks if he can be a clerk in that leather goods store, which must have been an humiliating thing to do. But he is willing to do anything to support his family. Then he hears of this man named Abraham Lincoln, says, "I want him to be elected." He did not want the new union to break up. And then when the southern states starts seceding, that really gets into Grant's gut. Emotionally, he wanted to keep the Union together. He thought this secession was going to be utter collapse for the country. And so one of his friends says, "Come on, get back into the game. We need you as a leader in the military." He is a nobody, but he gets command of an Illinois regiment, and he feels at home. He's got orders to go out to Kentucky, which is a border state. Lincoln wants to keep Kentucky in. He says it's as important. If we lose Kentucky, we could lose all of the South. And Grant goes to this community and assures the people there with this proclamation he puts on the walls. He is there to preserve their rights as citizens, that he is not there to do anyone harm. And he occupies Paducah, Kentucky without a single shot being fired. Lincoln notices that and notices he has a heart for what he is doing. He starts having some real successes out there. And to continue on, he has the he achieves almost of his own, of course, with others and with his troops, the first real victory of the Union at Fort Donelson in February of 1862. And useless Grant now becomes unconditional surrender Grant. Is it amazing that that old name from his childhood would go with him all the way to that point? He's promoted to major general and rises to national prominence. He has discovered he has a gift for military leadership. He's so good at battle command, battlefield strategy, and tactics. And he, as we know, his story may have been a huge part of saving the Union, which has allowed us to be who we are today. No one in God's eyes is ever useless, even when we feel like we may be so. Oh Lord, raise us to new life, and may we share your good news with our brothers and sisters everywhere. Amen.
Jesus went through Galilee, preaching and healing and showing compassion to those in need. As God comes no less today to those for whom we pray, let us offer our prayers to God, saying,
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
Creator of all, look with favor upon the peoples of the world. In your mercy, give to all people the necessities of a dignified life.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
Ruler of creation, instill wisdom and understanding among the leaders of nations. Guide them into ways of justice and peace.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
Spirit of the living Christ, fill us with expectation and eager longing for the coming of that day when no one will suffer, but when all will be gathered together in the heavenly joy and eternal prosperity.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
Heavenly Father, we give our thanks to all of the people who cannot do their jobs remotely, yet upon whom we depend. Store clerks and those who stock the shelves, receptionists and waiters, those who keep the power plants operating, those who collect our garbage, and those who clean our church, columbariums, and the sacred grounds each week.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
Great physician, bring healing to all who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. We pray for those we know and love, and for those known only to you. Inspire us to care for your gifts of healthy bodies and minds.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
For those who are sick or in need of our prayers, including Tatum, Tom, Phyllis Porche's family, Kevin and Mary Jo and family, Kathy, Linda, Sean, Aaron, Adelaide and Lillian, Bill, Lorraine, Nick and Dawn, Dick and Holly, Andrew, Kathy, Julia, Fran, Ted, Grady, Bunny, Norman, David, Austin, Luke, Nancy, Robin, Deb, Carol, Dan, Sue, John, Bob, Joe, Tori, Betsy, Marianne, Dick and Miriam, Jim, Joan, Kim, Ed and Carol, Marcia, Shirley and Charlie, Jean, Glenn, Anthony and Pat.
Lord, have mercy.
For U.S. Capitol Police Officer Brian Sicknick, who was killed by rioters at the Capitol on January 6th, And for the other four persons who died, Ashley Babbitt, Roseanne Boylan, Kevin Greeson, Benjamin Phillips, and for the two officers who committed suicide after the aftermath, we pray that they may abide forever in your nearer presence, O Lord. For their grieving families and for all those who were injured or threatened in the insurrection, we pray.
Lord, have mercy.
We also pray for those celebrating another year of life, Hunter Pittington, Steve Blackstock, Kathleen Stacy, Joan Rauscher, and Jennifer Hicks.
Lord, have mercy.
All this we ask, O God, in the name of Christ who died and rose for us, and whose coming in glory we await. Accept our prayers and praises through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. And God, unmute yourselves for this. God's people say,
Amen.
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 That was cool. That was really cool. All right, dear friends, the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
All right. It's good to mute. Okay, I think Steve already muted everybody. All right, dear friends, let us pray as our Lord taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. I'm going to take the ashes in this large container. Is this not amazing? All of these ashes are going to serve maybe 50 folks. So and then these two containers. I'm going to hold all of these together. And we'll pray together. Almighty God, you have created us out of the dust of the earth. Grant that these ashes may be to us a sign of our mortality and penitence, that we may remember it is only by your gracious gift that we are given everlasting life through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. So as of Wednesday, these ashes will be in containers and you may come pick them up from this Wednesday to the next. Now let us pray for that spiritual communion until the day that we may share in God's feast, literally, with each other, together. And let us pray. In union, O Lord, with the faithful of your church, where the Holy Eucharist is now being celebrated, we desire to offer you praise and thanksgiving. We present to you our souls and bodies with the earnest wish that we may always be united to you. And since we cannot now receive you sacramentally, we beseech you to come spiritually into our hearts. We unite ourselves with you and embrace you with all the love of our souls. Let nothing ever separate you from us. May we live in you and may you live in us, both in this life and in the life to come. Amen. May Christ, the Son of God, be manifest in you, that your lives may be a light to the world. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Mother and Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.